All right. Good morning. I want to extend a warm welcome to all our visitors with us this morning. Thank you so much for being here. In the back after the service, we have a doorway lunch and a little bit more information about the church if you'd like to attend. We'd love to have you join us immediately following the service. And for everyone else, how many of you are glad to be here in the service today? You want to hear God speak to you? Amen. That's like three quarters of you. How many of you really want to hear God's voice today? Let me see your, okay. Fantastic. Let's lift up our hands today just as we pray. God, I pray in the name of Jesus that we would hear your voice today. It's why we've gathered. It's why we've come. We want to experience and know you and understand what your will and purpose is for our life. And so, Lord, you see these hands that are raised today. God, we pray, open up our ears and open up our eyes that we might hear and see what it is that you're doing in our own lives. Bless this time as we open up your word in Jesus' name. And everybody that wanted that said amen. Amen, amen. Well, a few weeks ago, I got a distressed phone call from my mother-in-law. And she was on the phone with me and she said, hey, the battery in my car is dead. Can you come and help me jumpstart my car? And I said, oh, absolutely, no problem. I'll be there in just a few minutes. I'm not too far from where you are. And so I got into my car, made sure I had jumper cables, got into the car, drove to her house. We had to kind of pull her car out and put our cars right next to each other. As I opened up the hood, got everything secure and pulled out my jumper cables. I've done this a couple of times before, but I remembered, okay, red goes on red, right? Right, okay. Black goes on black. I think I remembered all that. So I put the red on the red. I put the black on the black. I started my car. Everything was going good. I got out of my car. It was looking good. I was looking at my car, and all of a sudden, boom, the hood fell down on my mother-in-law's car. And as it fell down, like within a second, smoke started billowing out of the car. I could see little sparks and flames kind of shoot up. And I was, and in an instant, I was trying to think through, what am I going to do? Do I touch the car? Is the car, like if I touch it, am I going to get electrocuted? Like what's going on? And smoke continues to billow out, and then this really powerful stench starts coming. And so I'm like, I instantly kind of touch the car, make sure everything's okay. I lift up the hood, smoke is like, I'm coughing, and I reach in and I pull out the cable from the car. And immediately as I touched it, my hand was like burned. It was so hot. I pulled the cables off, looked at them. The metal on the cables was melted. It was, I mean, in just a few seconds, there was so much power from these batteries that were connected to each other. And I learned a couple of powerful lessons that day, just 2 weeks ago. Here's the first one. Don't ever ask me to jumpstart your car. That's the first thing, okay? For those of you that know me well enough, I am not mechanically inclined at all. My wife says, don't do any home improvement projects at our house. It costs more money when you do it than if I call someone else. That's the first lesson I learned. The second lesson I learned is simply this, that when you put a positive and a negative together, you get a lot of power. Can you say power with me this morning? Power. When you have a positive and a negative, you get a lot of power. And in life, that is very interesting because we all have these positive and negative experiences in our life. And most of us, we enjoy the positive experiences, those things that just kind of come our way and it's easygoing and life is good and we get the promotion or we get the raise or whatever it is. But when a negative comes into our lives, I don't know, but if you're like me, I want to get out of a negative situation as quick as I possibly can. I don't want to just stay there and go, oh, I'm just enjoying all of this. I'm enjoying the conflict and the frustration and the worry and the pressure. Anybody out there, you just thrive on that, all the pressure and the frustration? No, of course not, right? If you're like me, you want to get out of that as quickly as possible. But if we look at life in such a way that we can see the negative experiences in our life, how many of you know you're going to be in a negative experience in your life? It's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when, right? And some of you right now are in the middle of a negative experience. Some of you right now are in a crisis moment. And I want to tell you something today, that if you follow Jesus, if you walk with Jesus, if you're trying to listen and be obedient to what he has for your life, he can take a negative situation, infuse it with who he is, and produce great power. This is what God has for your life. And so God seemingly takes the negative situations in our lives and he creates positive things. I think about this scripture in Romans 8:28, and it says this, and we know that God causes all things. Everybody say all things. God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose. We know that. God causes what? All things, everything, to work together for what? For good, to those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. This is why I want to challenge you today in the negative situation that you're faced with today, in the crisis that you may be in today. I want to challenge you to not necessarily try to run from it, but allow God to infuse himself into your situation and take the negative and the positive and create great power in your life. When you allow the seemingly negative issues that come your way and combine them with the positive forces of God's love and grace, he takes your negative and doesn't just give us a positive, he gives us power to overcome in our life. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9 puts it this way, God's power is perfected in my weakness. In your weakness, God's power is perfected. How many of you would say, I'm weak? Okay, some of you would say that. That's great. Now, I want you to understand something. When you acknowledge your weakness, God's power is perfected in your life. You see, when you try to do things in your own strength and in your own power, if you kind of say, well, I've got this, I can handle this, God's power is not able to be perfected in your life. Because then there's pride. And you do things on your own, and God says, okay, I'll let you do it on your own. But when you give up and when you say, I'm weak and I can't handle this, then it's at that point that God can perfect his power in your life. How many of you would say, yes, I need power in my life for a situation that I'm going through right now? Oh, my goodness. Look at all these hands. Yeah, they're going up. You need God's power in your life. God loves taking difficult situations and turning them around for his good. Did you know that? God wants to take your difficult situation, your crisis, your moment right now. He wants to take it and turn it upside down. But you have to get to the place where you say, God, I surrender, I give it up. It's whatever you want to do in my life. When you do that, his power is perfected in your life. And he'll do things in your life that you could have never imagined, that you could have never dreamed of. He'll create solutions and understandings and perspective and wisdom that you never would have had on your own until you come to the place and you say, God, I'm weak. Would you be strong in my weakness? That's what God wants to do for you. Last week, we talked about Daniel and his three friends. And we're in the middle of a series called Brave. I want every single one here at Cross Point Church to be brave, to be courageous. And last week we talked about Daniel and his friends, and they were prisoners of war. They were living in Jerusalem with not a care in the world. And up comes this great and mighty king, King Nebuchadnezzar. And he surrounds the city, and as he surrounds the city, he tears down the walls. He takes people captive and brings them from Jerusalem all the way to Babylon. And Daniel and his three friends, who are teenagers, find themselves now not living in their hometown, not living in comfortable surroundings. They've been drugged halfway across the world, and now they're living in Babylon. It's a different culture. It's a different place. It's a different language. Everything that they know is gone. And the Babylonians have tried to strip everything from them. They've changed their names. They've changed their diet. They've changed their language. They've changed what they were learning and what they were reading and what they were studying. Everything has been turned upside down in their lives. They've been in the palace in a training program for 3 years, learning all the ways of the Babylonians. They were to learn things about the wisdom and the culture and the literature of the Babylonians. In addition to that, God gave these men Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego and Daniel and all of these guys, God gave them extra wisdom. In Daniel chapter 1, at the end of the chapter, it says that God gave Daniel even wisdom and insight when it came to dreams. And then we find ourselves in Daniel chapter 2. And this is where we kind of pick up the story. Daniel now is living in Babylon. He's living in a comfortable place. Unbeknownst to Daniel, the king, Nebuchadnezzar, is laying on his bed. And he's thinking about the future. And this is what the king begins to think about as he's thinking about his kingdom and his palace and all of the glories and wonders that he has achieved himself. He begins to fall asleep. And as he falls asleep, he has this dream. And as he begins to dream, he begins to get a little bit terrified and worried, challenged internally, not knowing exactly what this dream is all about. And then he wakes up in the middle of the night. Anybody of you ever had a dream that you've woken up in the dead of night? You've had a dream that maybe scares you? Anybody ever had one of those nightmare dreams before? My kids, you know, they're 9 years old, and they've gone through this season where just in the last, year or so, they've woken up in the middle of the night because they were terrified by dreams. And I'd come in and pray with them and talk with them, but a dream can rattle you. It can shake you. It can really make you begin to wonder, was that for me, or was that just what I ate last night, or where did this dream come from? And Nebuchadnezzar has this dream, and he wakes up, and he's like, this is a dream that is so powerful. I know it means something, but I can't quite put my hands on it. I don't know what it means. And so then he begins to do something that any Babylonian would have done at this particular time in history. You see, those in Babylon, they had what they called a dream book. And all the wise men, the enchanters and astrologers and all these people, it was very popular at the time, they would have these dream books that they would go to. And they would look inside the book and they would ask you, what did you dream? And if you dreamed about a cow or an eagle or an animal or whatever, they would look up in their dictionary of dreams and they would say, oh, well, this is what this means. Because you dreamed of an eagle, your life is going to be prosperous. Or because you dreamed of, and I've read through some of this stuff this week, it's kind of crazy. You dreamed of a cow, man, your life is going to go down quick. And your future is not very bright. And they had all of these meanings attached to the images and symbols that people would have in their dreams. And so Nebuchadnezzar, he calls for the wise men of the community to come before him. But he realizes and recognizes that this dream is so important. It's so valuable. It's shooken him to his foundation that he begins to issue a request that shakes the wise men. He says, I want you to not only tell me what my dream means, I want you to tell me what I dreamed. And the wise men who have gathered together, they were like, oh, great and mighty king, we would be happy to tell you what your dream means. We've got books and theories and all of these kind of things. Would you just tell us what you dreamed, and then we'll tell you the meaning of the dream? And this is where we pick up the story. It says here in Daniel chapter 2, the king replied, I know what you are doing. You're stalling for time because you know I'm serious when I say, if you don't tell me the dream, you're doomed. So you have conspired to tell me lies, hoping I will change my mind, but tell me the dream, and then I'll know that you can tell me what it means. So the wise people are saying, no, you tell us what the dream is and we'll tell you what it means. And the king says, no, you tell me what I dreamed and then I'll tell you what it means. He was throwing down the gauntlet with these men. He was like, I want to know and to be confident and sure that you really know what you're talking about, because this dream had so rattled him. It was an impossible request. The wise men, their backs were up against a wall, and they said this. They said, no one can do this. Only the gods can understand and know what you dreamed. And Daniel and his friends were part of this wise men contingent. And the king gave the order to have them killed arrested and rounded up and taken and killed. He was angry and frustrated and worried, and he knew this dream was significant. Daniel didn't know it yet, but he was in the middle of a crisis. His back was against a wall, and he didn't even know it yet. And so I have this question that I want each of us to ponder and think through this morning is, what do you do when you're faced with a crisis? What do you do when your back is against the wall, when you don't see any way out? See, Daniel and his friends and the wise men in Babylon, their backs were against a wall. There was nothing and nowhere they could go. They couldn't read his mind. They didn't have the understanding, and their back was against the wall. What do you do when things don't make sense to you? When something's being asked of you that you're saying, that's impossible. There's no way that I could do X, Y, or Z. What do you do when you faced and are challenged with a crisis moment? There are three things today that I want us to kind of hold to and cling to that I believe will help us be courageous and brave, that will help us overcome in our lives so that we can be those who can overcome and be confident and be brave in how God calls us to walk in life. And the first one is this, that you need to, in a crisis moment, in a moment where you're a little bit discouraged and maybe frustrated and don't know where to go, you need to take a step back. Take a step back. Step back. Daniel 2:14 says this, when Arioch, the commander of the king's guard, came to kill them, Daniel handled the situation with wisdom and discretion. Daniel didn't freak out. I think, look at this verse. When Arioch, the commander of the king's guard, came to kill them. I'm here to kill you. Go ahead, collect your belongings. You don't need them, but go ahead and come. I don't know about you, but I'd be running out the back door. You see the movies and people, you know, run away and they're doing everything they can to be chased or whatever. Daniel talks to the commander. He handles the situation with wisdom and discretion. Oftentimes in life, I think, instead of taking a step back, we freak out, we give up, it's all over, the sky is falling, it's not working out, it's not like I planned it was. Maybe you got a report from a doctor and it's not a good report and you go, it's all over, the sky is falling, I'm gonna die, or this or that or whatever it is. Or maybe you're in a relationship right now and you've just gotten really bad news and your kid never doesn't want to talk to you anymore, and you're like, I can't handle this anymore, and you freak out and you say things that you know you shouldn't say. This is not how Daniel handled the situation. He took a step back. He didn't give up. And I want to tell you this today. Don't give up on the dreams that God has given you. Don't give up in the middle of the crisis that you find yourself in. Don't give up in the situations in life that seem so difficult and challenging. Don't give up. Take a step back. Don't quit. Daniel was used by God for 80 plus years because he didn't quit. He didn't panic. He didn't freak out. He handled the situation with wisdom and discretion. If you're in the middle of a negative circumstance that seems to be getting the best of you, recognize that these circumstances are tutors for you for a bright and prosperous future. The crisis that you're in, the challenge that you're faced with right now, God can turn it around for your good if you don't quit. God can turn it around and make it good for you if you just step back and relax and allow God to work in your life. Proverbs 24:10 says this, if you faint in the day of adversity, your strength is small. And I love how the Message translation put it. If you fall to pieces in a crisis, there wasn't much to you in the first place. Don't fall to pieces in a crisis. Can I say that again? Don't fall to pieces. Know that God is right there with you in the middle of life's storms right now. God is with you. No matter what you're faced with, the challenge that you have, you fill in that blank. Recognize that God is with you. 2 Corinthians 4, 8, and 9 says it this way. We are afflicted in every way, but we're not crushed. We're perplexed, but not driven to despair. Some of you, you're driven to despair in the crisis moment of your life. And Paul here in Corinthians, he says this, don't be driven to despair. You may be perplexed. You may not understand why it is that you're going through what you're going through, and it's not fair, and it doesn't seem right and appropriate, and God, where are you? But Paul says this, he issues this challenge, don't be driven to despair. Don't be driven to hopelessness. Some of you are persecuted, but you're not forsaken. You're struck down, but you're not destroyed. You see, God has a purpose and a plan for what you're going through right now. And I want to challenge you. Take a step back. Don't quit. Don't faint. Don't freak out. Take a step back. This is what Daniel does. He says in Daniel 2, verse 15, he asked Arioch, the commander, the guy that was knocking on his door, he said, why has the king issued such a harsh decree? So Arioch told him all that had happened. You see, Daniel didn't panic. He began asking reasonable questions. You know, in the midst of panic and despair and crisis moments, I don't know about you, but I always look for the person who has some composure. Someone who's steady in the midst of crisis. Someone who's not willing to, like, freak out and worry and stress and begin to talk and put out rumors and all these kinds of things. Daniel is composed. He's just been given a death order. His life is hanging in the balance. And with composure and calmness, he recognizes something so significant. My life is in God's hands. Since my life is in God's hands, I can be composed. I can have real courage because my life is in God's hands. The crisis that you're in right now, the stress moment that you're going through right now, I want you to know this. If you're a believer in Jesus, Jesus is right there beside you. And you can be composed in the midst of difficulty and heartache and despair. You can be composed and take courage, knowing that God's in control. Daniel knew that. And so he begins to ask questions. He says, why is the king in such a big hurry to kill us? Why this? Why that? And he begins to ask significant questions. If you can't stay composed in a crisis, it's going to be difficult for you to lead your family. If you can't stay composed in a crisis, it's going to be hard for you to lead at work. It's going to be hard for you to lead in any kind of capacity. And as a dad or a mom or as a brother or sister or aunt or uncle or a boss or even an employee, it's important that we compose ourselves and not scream the sky is falling, but be composed and say, you know what? God's in control. The world around me may be shaking and falling and things aren't going the way I thought they were going to go, but internally, even though that there's storm all around me, internally I can have peace and be composed because God is with me. How many of you can say that today, that even in the midst of my storm, God is with me? And if he's with me, who can be against me? You see, this is the composure that we have as believers, that we can say, despite life's storms, I can be composed, even in a crisis. And it's necessary, if you're going to be a leader in your family, to not freak out, to not worry, to be composed, and to challenge your family to say, listen, God's got it under control. He stepped back. Daniel stepped back. He took a moment. He requested more time. How many of you have ever been in a crisis moment and you've said the wrong thing out of anger or fear, and it comes out of your lips, and you go, I want that back? You've said something that hurt somebody or wounded somebody because you're in the middle of a crisis, and you're all stressed, and life is tough, and you've reacted to what's happening to you, and later you regret it. Proverbs 21 says this, watch your tongue and keep your mouth shut, and you'll stay out of trouble. If you're in the middle of a crisis, would you just keep your mouth shut? How many of you lift your hand and say, okay, I can at least do that. As a minimum, I can just keep my mouth shut and I'll stay out of trouble. Can you do that for me? You'll try. That's good. Maybe your spouse or your loved one, your friend can hold you accountable on that. The story goes on in Daniel chapter 2. Daniel went at once to see the king and requested more time. He took a step back. He requested more time to tell the king what the dream meant. What was the one thing that the astrologers and enchanters were asking for? They were asking for time. Give us more time. And the king was saying, no, I know what you're trying to do. You're just trying to prolong things. And what's the one thing that Daniel asked for? Time. The king grants time for Daniel. Why? Because he's composed. He looks like he's confident that there's something different about him. You're going to be faced with crisis moments in your life, and the people around you are going to see that there's the Spirit of God on you. They won't be able to recognize and tell that it's the Spirit of God on you, but they're going to be able to recognize and say and see this on you, and they're going to be able to give you the time and the space necessary to do the thing that you need to do. But if you're freaking out, just like everyone else, they're not going to give you the time of day. Daniel was courageous. He was brave in the moment, went up to the king of Babylon and said, I need more time. So he took a step back. Sometimes you need to take a step back so you can look up. That's point number two, look up. It's easy to trust God when everything is going well. How many of you know that? Life is good, your kids are good, the money's good, the job's good, the health is good, everything is going well. It's easy to trust God. It's easy for life just to kind of move along. But you throw in one little crisis moment and it gets a little bit more challenging, doesn't it? I know in my own life when my wife and I were struggling to have kids, and for 1 year and 3 years and 4 years and 5 years, and God wasn't releasing anything to us, and we were praying and asking him, God, would you give us the desire of our hearts? We want to have kids. There's nowhere we could go but look up. Look up, God. I want to look to you because you're the author of everything. It's easy when things are going well, but when things are tough, man, we're brought to our knees. And I would almost say this, that sometimes the difficult moments that come our way are really God's way of moving in your life so that you'll get to your knees. So all of you that raised your hand and said, man, I'm in a crisis moment, I'm in a really stressful moment, that's God bringing you into those situations. He doesn't cause harm and evil. That's not what I'm saying. But difficult situations, I think sometimes he has a hand in that because he wants you on your knees. He wants you to say, I'm weak, you're strong. He wants you to recognize that you come to the end of yourself so that you can recognize it's him that you need, not your strength. And so Daniel, he looks up to God. He begins to cry out to God. It says in Scripture that he called his friends together. And I would almost wager to say this, that as he gathered his friends together, he might have said this to his friends, that God places us in impossible situations for no other reason than to help us learn to trust him and only him. As Daniel's with his three friends and he's gathering together, he's saying, listen, this is an impossible situation. How can we read the king's mind? But Daniel, I think, filled with faith, said, it's for no other reason than for us to learn to trust him and only him. Sometimes we put so much trust in ourselves. We put so much trust in our abilities or our friends or our finances or our checkbook or our car or that job or whatever it is that we neglect to understand that it's God who gives us everything that we need. And in Daniel 2, 17 and 18, Daniel went home, told his friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah what had happened. And verse 18, he urged them, to ask the God of heaven to show them his mercy by telling them the secret so they would not be executed along with the other wise men of Babylon. Daniel didn't panic. He prayed. He didn't speak ill of the king. He petitioned the king of heaven. God does the impossible. He specializes in the difficult and the challenging. And he works with you. And I know some of you are difficult and challenging. Say that again. Do you know some of you are difficult and challenging? I know because I'm difficult and I'm challenging. And God works with me. He works with the impossible. He loves working with the impossible to display his power. There is a God in heaven that reveals secrets. Can I say that again? There is a God in heaven who reveals secrets. The crisis moment that you're faced with right now, the answer and the solution, God knows. He knows exactly what it is. He knows what you should do and how you should do it and where you should go and what you should be, whether you should get on your knees, whether you should say something or keep your mouth shut. God knows the secret for your life. But he's not going to reveal that secret to you until you begin to look up, until you begin to petition him. And I would wager to say that what Daniel did was so significant, he didn't just pray by himself. He gathered his friends together. And I ask this question today. In your crisis moment right now, do you have people in your life that you can go to and you can ask them to pray with you? Because if you're in the middle of a crisis situation and you don't have those people, it's too late. This is why we encourage every single one of you here at Crosspoints to get involved in a small group, to have fellowship with other believers, so that when the crisis moment comes, and it will come multiple times in your life, you'll have people around you that will be able to lay hands on you and pray for you and encourage you and speak words of life to you. And Daniel had his small group right there in the house, and they began to pray and ask God to move on their behalf, saying, God, grant us mercy. Who do you have that you can call on in the middle of a crisis? I know for Heather and I, as we were praying about kids, we had people over into our house. They joined with us in prayer, crying out to God on our behalf. I know many of you prayed for us that we would have kids. We gathered together and prayed. When I was in the middle of a crisis in terms of trying to figure out what I was going to do after seminary and whether I was going to start a church or going to get another church in another city or maybe become the lead pastor here, I gathered together my friends and we began to pray and to cry out to God. It's so great to have people around you that you can pray with and interact with. And sometimes I think we forget that. The other thing that Daniel did is he prayed for mercy. He was praying very specifically, God, would you reveal the secret to us? And if there's one thing I could say as a pastor, when it comes to prayer, would you be specific? I hear these prayers all the time. God, I pray that you would bless all the babies in the world. Would you bring peace on earth? God, would you feed all the hungry people in the world? I'm not necessarily discounting those prayers, but could you make it a little bit more specific? In your prayers, in your crisis, and in your moment, Daniel was specific. He said, would you reveal the secret to us? In your moment, in your crisis, be very specific. If it's a job situation, God, you know I can't stand my boss. He's irritating to me. This is how specific God wants you to be. He already knows what you're thinking anyways. You might as well pray it out. God, he irritates me. He's done this and this and that and this. But God, would you intervene and change my heart if necessary? God, would you open up a way so that I can have this promotion or I can have this day off or whatever. God wants you to be very specific and he'll reveal the mystery to you. It might be a heart change in your own life or it might be something that God wants to do in the life of someone else. But God loves to take the impossible and make something possible out of it. Matthew 18:20 says this, for where there are two or three gathered together as my followers, I am there among them. When you gather together with other believers, there is power. God is with you. Not only are we called to step back and look up, we're also called to step out. Daniel 2:24, it says, Daniel went to see Arioch, whom the king had ordered to execute the wise men of Babylon. And Daniel said to him, "Don't kill the wise men. Take me to the king, and I will tell him the meaning of his dream. I will tell him the meaning of his dream." Daniel didn't just step back. He didn't just put his life on pause. Daniel also didn't just look up. He didn't just allow God to kind of magically work everything together. Daniel walked out what was revealed in his life. Daniel walked it out. When you look up, God will allow you to step out. Can I say that? When you look up, God will allow you to step out. God will give you wisdom and insight. He may not be able to speak to you in a dream. It might not be audible. But rest assured, God wants to speak to you in your situation. Sometimes it might be a word from a friend or a spouse. It might be something that you just know in your heart of hearts. You may hear God's still, small voice. God might speak through you, through the word, through a scripture. But whatever and however it is that God speaks to you, you need to walk it out. Don't get stuck in life. Don't drift and wander or doubt or worry. Because Daniel 2:28 says this, "There is a God in heaven who reveals secrets, and he has shown King Nebuchadnezzar what will happen in the future. I will tell you your dream and the visions you saw as you lay on your bed." I promise you, there is a God in heaven that reveals secrets for you. And as my wife and I were crying out, and as we gathered friends together, after 10 years, God revealed his secret. As our boys were born on our 15th wedding anniversary, after 10 years of praying out, God revealed the secret to us that all the times and the moments of crying and praying and shouting and screaming and not understanding, God moved on our behalf. And all of those moments, those negative moments, fashioned and formed within us something that we never could have had happen in our lives had we not had those moments of desperation and crying out to God, because God took us to our needs so that we could become dependent upon him in an ever-increasing measure. You see, God wants to do that in your life. He wants to take you to your knees so he can reveal the secret, so he can work something deep in your life. If you're humble, if you approach God in a humble way, he'll reveal secrets to you. But when he reveals that secret to you, don't be silent. Don't keep it in. Walk it out. Whatever God has for you, walk it out. Because if you're silent, God can use even a donkey to speak out. If you're quiet, God can make the rocks and the stones cry out on your behalf. God wants you to speak up with whatever situation you're faced with. If you're in a crisis with your kids and God is speaking you to say something, you better say something. God wants you to keep your mouth shut. Keep your mouth shut. Whatever it is, walk it out that God has for you. You see, impossible situations test you, but prove God. Impossible situations test you and prove God. And when we're faced with impossible situations, it's not enough to step back, because you'll get stuck. And it's not enough just to look up. As important as it is, God doesn't want you just to be a single solitary saint on a mountain. It's not enough just to step back. It's not enough just to look up. And it's not enough just to step out. Because if you step out without looking up, you'll make the wrong decision every time. You need to do all three. You need to step back. You need to look up. And you need to step out. We were putting this message together with some of the team. I had come up with three different phrases, and they thought it was cheesy, and so I used these words that these guys gave me, but I'm going to give you my cheesy words because I think you might remember it better. So here's the first one. Don't give up. Don't give up. Daniel didn't give up. Look up. Step up. All right? Don't give up. Look up. Step up. That's what God has for you. Don't allow the impossible situations in your life to keep you from the great opportunities that God has in front of you. I'll leave you with this last quote from one of my favorite preachers, Chuck Swindoll. He says this: we are all faced with a series of great opportunities disguised as impossible situations. Every single one of you, you're faced with a series of great opportunities. The crisis moment that you're in right now, it's a great opportunity for God to do something impossible in your life. I pray that you would be brave this week as you trust God. Would you bow your heads in prayer with me this morning? Father, I pray for every single person here, Lord, that you would empower them to live out these three truths, that we'd not quit, we wouldn't give up, we'd look up to you, and we'd step up. If that's you this morning, I just want you to raise your hand. I want to pray for you specifically. You're in the middle of that crisis situation. God, you see these hands that are in the middle of situations that they seemingly have their backs to the wall. I pray today, oh God, that you would reveal your secret to them, the secret for their situation, the secret for their scenario. God, that they wouldn't be powerless, but that they would be filled with your power. Lord, that the negative situation that they're faced with, Lord, would be coupled with your positive experience in their life that would produce so much power that they would be overcomers in life. Lord, I thank you for them and ask that you would bless them in the mighty name of Jesus. If there's someone here today who doesn't know Jesus, you've never committed your life to Christ, I want to ask you and I want to challenge you today. God might be drawing to you. Even today, you're experiencing a crisis moment. You're in a negative experience. You can't find your way out. I'm telling you, there's only one answer. There's only one solution: Jesus Christ. He died for you. He died so much for you because he loves you so much. He wants to give you purpose and passion and peace. Doesn't mean that he's going to take away all those crisis moments, but I guarantee you this, he'll use those crisis moments to create great power in your life for his name. If that's you and you would just say, yeah, I want to receive Jesus. I want to get out of this crisis moment. I want to turn my back on the world, on sin. I know I've done things that I've regretted. Man, I want to make a brand new start today. If that's you today and you want to say, yeah, I want to give my life to Jesus, I simply want to ask you to raise your hand and I'll give you an opportunity to pray and ask Jesus into your life, and he'll make you into a brand new person. The old will be gone, the new will come. As you confess your sin and say yes, as you get on your knees and you say, I'm weak, God will give you his power. If that's you, just raise your hand right now. I want to pray for you right where you are in your seat. I see that hand. Anybody else that would say, yeah, that's me. I want to receive Jesus Christ in my life. I don't want to keep doing it in my own strength or my own power anymore. Anybody else? I see that hand back there. Anybody else that would say, yes, that's me. I need Jesus in my life. This is why we gather today as a body of Christians, because we know that God has turned our lives upside down, and we want to see him move in your life just as much as he's moved in ours. We're weak, but he's strong. Anybody else that would just say, yeah, that's me. I want to receive Jesus Christ. I need him in my life. Amen. Well, I'm going to have the church pray with us as we pray with you. You're just going to repeat after me. God's going to come into your life. He's going to make you into a new person. Just repeat after me. You'll make this your own prayer. Jesus, I'm a sinner. I want to turn from my old ways. And I want to walk and follow you. I believe you died on the cross. And I believe you rose again to give me new life. I repent. I turn from my sin. And I turn to you. Thank you for washing me white as snow, for erasing the past and putting me on a new path. I trust you. I'm going to follow you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen.